Sao Paulo, Brazil, the largest city in all the Americas. Boasting a population of over 12 million people, Sampa, as the residents call it for short, is a lively 24-hour city that has big city hustle blended with the laid-back Brazilian vibe. It's also a city that's overflowing with culture. It's a beautiful mix of historical and contemporary attractions, museums, shopping, and sprawling parks during the day, and a vibrant nightlife featuring bars, sports, live music, and food. Speaking of the food, Sao Paulo's gastronomy is world-renowned. If you like good food, you'll love it here. They have some of the best restaurants in the world, and the street food is legendary. It's also a short car trip from some of the most pristine beaches in the world. I've been living in Sampa for a year and running my podcast from here while training at one of the best schools in the city, Vila de Luta, the academy of UFC star and jiu-jitsu legend Damian Maia. Between the tough training, the good food, and the 24-hour attractions, Sao Paulo has so much to offer. I've made tons of friends here, and we also welcomed my daughter to the world here in September. It has quickly become my favorite city in the world. As wonderful as Sao Paulo is, just like every major city in the world, it has its share of problems. There's a pretty high rate of homelessness, and many areas of the city are best to be avoided at night. One of the most common questions I get from people living outside of Brazil is, how safe is it there? To which I always answer, every city in the world has areas that are dangerous, and it's good to be alert no matter where you go. However, the truth is, the crime rate in Brazil is significantly higher than the US. Brazil's currently ranked number 7 in the world for the highest crime rate. Generally speaking, the most dangerous areas in Brazil are the slums, called favelas. They're in every city, and they typically started as shanty towns that grew into small cities within a city. The vast majority of people living in favelas are decent people who are just trying to get by, but favelas can have a rather lawless culture inside, and they're often controlled and enforced by gangs. Outsiders are often urged to not go to these areas due to the risk. But while Sao Paulo has several favelas, it also harbors another area considered by residents to be the most dangerous of all. To be clear, it's not a favela. It's a roughly 6-block radius near the center of the city that's been completely taken over by drug addicts and the violent drug gangs that supply them. You can't find this neighborhood's name on a map of Sao Paulo, but residents call it Crackolândia, which is Portuguese for literally crackland. Crackolândia is an extremely distressed area that Sao Paulo's local government has struggled for years to contain. Residents describe the area as something out of Walking Dead, where addicts roam around like zombies and openly use narcotics in the streets day and night. While living here, I've seen in the news the violence and riots that break out on almost a weekly basis between the military police and the drug gangs that control the area. Police are faced with a battle royale of drug dealers who fight them and also each other for turf, as well as the extremely unpredictable mob mentality of the addicts, who number in the thousands. Sao Paulo's military police must enter in full force to perform operations, risking their lives every time they go in. I've been told explicitly by friends, family, and training partners here in Brazil to stay far away from the area at all costs, and I definitely took their advice. I never even considered going anywhere close to Crackolândia, until I had a random chance meeting with a listener of my podcast. Sao Paulo has no shortage of good jiu-jitsu. While my home base here has been Damian Maia's gym, I've had the pleasure of dropping into other schools as well. One of which was the gym of another Sao Paulo legend, Professor Marco Barbosa. While training there, I met Lyle Rodriguez, who is one of Barbosa's black belts and a highly active competitor. He's been on the scene for a long time, and he's competed all across Brazil and also in the US, racking up some impressive local and regional titles along the way. Like me, Lyle's also a content creator in the jiu-jitsu community. He has a podcast of his own in Portuguese called the BJJ Bump, which he invited me to be a guest on. And also like me, he's the father of a little girl. He made sure that all my visits to the academy went smoothly, which I really appreciated since it was literally on the opposite side of the city from my apartment. After training together only a couple times, we quickly became good friends. Lyle is also a teacher and told me that he would really like me to come check out his social project where he teaches underprivileged kids.
Funny stories to you guys. I met Ryan at a practice in Barbosa Jiu-Jitsu. Then I know your show. I really like to listen to your podcast. So you Ryan, come on, let's train. I have a program in the downtown São Paulo with the kids. You should go there. And then he asked me, where is it? I say him. Is in Cracolândia. Then Ryan made it like this face. Oh, I don't know. Let me ask Karen. And she said, no, Cracolândia is too dangerous.
Despite my initial reservations, the more Lyle talked about the program, the more I was intrigued to check it out. I'm a sucker for anything that helps people in need, especially for kids, and even more so if it's done through jiu-jitsu. Something I didn't previously consider about Cracolândia is that many of the addicts have children who have to live there as well. There's also a lot of kids who live in nearby favelas and also a housing project just a few blocks away, whose parents aren't addicts but live there because of the affordable housing. In either scenario, it means that these kids have to traverse some pretty dangerous streets every day. For 8 years, Lyle and his wife Joanna have been getting these kids off the street and into their social project called Projeto Novos Sonhos, which is Portuguese for the New Dreams Project. Joanna teaches ballet while Lyle teaches jiu-jitsu. It's a 100% non-profit program that allows the kids and also their parents to come in and learn jiu-jitsu for free. After 8 years of dedication, they're just beginning to see the results in their first generation of kids. Against all odds, several of the kids have graduated high school, a few have gone off to college, and others have joined the military. Lyle feels that this pattern is the beginning of dissolving Cracolândia for good. Show the new generation a path for success and guide them on it so they can escape Cracolândia forever. The more kids that escape, the more the population shrinks over time until it's gone. Despite the risk, I couldn't miss out on seeing this program for myself. After a long talk with my wife, promising her I'd be careful, I called Lyle and told him I'm coming. Although I was feeling really inspired by Lyle and his program, I still hadn't lost sight of the fact that I'm a gringo who plans on entering Sao Paulo's highest risk area. I wanted to get a little more advice before going there, and thankfully I knew just the guy to talk to. Professor Silvio Moraes is one of Damian Maia's respected black belts. He's a staple at Vila Deluta and someone who I became friends with while training here. One of my favorite things about training here is hearing Silvio talk about the insane things he deals with at work every day. Silvio is a highly ranked member of Sao Paulo's Narcotics Task Force, an elite unit that performs operations all over Sao Paulo, including Cracolândia. He knows the area well and has plenty experience there.
My name is Silvio Moraes. I'm working DENARC, Drug Task Force from Polícia Civil de Sao Paulo. I have been on the force since 91, about 27, 28 years. I have been working with narcotics since 2010. Cracolândia is very, very old. The old Cracolândia was in another place close to where it is today. Cracolândia starts when the crack arrives in São Paulo streets, and the people start to be addicted by crack, and crack is the most devastating drugs ever. It makes the addicts as a zombie, literally as a zombie. They just live to use crack. So right now, we're Cracolândia is in São Paulo City. Super hard to control it, especially when they promote some revolts, you know, that some against the police or against the state. It's very hard to work, to fight against the dealers, because they keep hiding. Between the addicts, you know, you see them, but you think he's an addict, you know, and we cannot entry and the crowd. If some policemen try to enter in the crowd, he will kill it. There is no way. It's like if you see The Walking Dead, it's the same. They will kill the police with the kicks, with the sticks, knives, even bites. it sounds weird, but it's true. It's true.
What's your opinion of me as a gringo going into Crocolandia?
You are a tough guy, because I don't have that courage. But for you, as a foreigner, you know, it's a good experience. Right now, you're a father of a beautiful girl. To see how hard is the world, you know, I think it can rise in your brain and in your soul some good developed thing, you know. But man, keep don't show them the expensive cameras, don't show any expensive thing, you know, and don't enter in the middle of the crowd. Keep it on the edge of the crowd, you know, because once the edge, you can run away. Okay, on the middle of the crowd, you can run, because they will grab you and they took you whatever you have.
I greatly appreciated Silvio's insight and advice, but it was a little troubling to hear that even he wouldn't go to Crackalangia by himself. But I couldn't get cold feet now. Lyle was coming to pick me up the following afternoon.
Hey, Lyle.
Hey.
C'est bon.
The following afternoon, Lyle scooped me up and we were off. During the 30-minute ride, he gave me a rundown on what to expect once we enter Crocolandia. He assured me that if I stuck close to him, I'd be safe. I've been to many rough neighborhoods in the US, and I've been through favelas in Brazil. In fact, my apartment in Sao Paulo is only a couple blocks from one of the city's largest favelas. But Crocolandia is a different animal, and I'd be lying if I said I wasn't a little nervous. As we approach the area, it's important that I conceal my camera the best I can. The addicts don't like to be filmed and will often cause a scene if cameras are present. But if the drug dealers see the camera, there's a high risk they may respond with violence. As we pull into the area, the first thing you notice is the smell in the air. It smells like a combination of burning plastic and nail salon chemicals. The unmistakable smell of burning crack cocaine. It was difficult to catch everything on camera due to safety, but the landscape was pretty grim. Seeing the area for myself in person was definitely a perspective-shifting experience. Almost everyone was smoking crack, and some addicts were even openly performing sexual acts, most likely in exchange for drugs. Also, this was around 3 in the afternoon. Lyle told me it was very tame compared to nighttime. It was stunning to imagine that there were kids living anywhere near this environment.
Crocolandia of São Paulo, it's a place, it's actually in the neighborhood of Bom Retiro in downtown São Paulo. People are on the streets taking drugs all day long, non-stop. So in 2015, they used to say there are almost 20,000 people on the streets of São Paulo taking drugs. This is our reality. But on this reality, we have good people living here. The people who doesn't have money, the people who can afford like a nice place to live, they choose to live here in downtown because it's cheaper. So they pay for like a bad place to live, and they need to deal with this kind of thing of Crocolandia. So the kids are seeing this scene of people who take drugs and all of these things they can with it. People having sex on the streets, prostitution, drug dealers, violence, and some of those kids, the people doesn't have much food to eat, all those daily needs. And this is our reality. I have people here who sometimes come to the class, they haven't eat all day. This is really hard because they came to the class and they start to run and etc. to warm up. In the middle of the warm up, they are fading, they're weak because they haven't eaten. So this is our reality. And here in the program, we have like the kitchen. They eat here. They have meals. They have lunch. Because probably if they don't lunch here, they can't lunch in other place.
Lyle pulled into a garage, and suddenly we were in the Novo Sogno social project. It was a complete change of environment, and I felt an immediate sense of tranquility. It was bright, and it had an incredible positive energy. This is clearly a place of safety and hope for kids in the area, an oasis in the concrete jungle. Lyle gave me the full tour, explaining all the things that they do for the kids, which is a lot. They have a full kitchen where they prepare meals for them, and they also provide food essentials that the kids can take home. They offer tutoring to help the kids improve their grades at school, as well as vocational training to help them prepare for the workforce. Clean geese and laundry service are provided for everyone. And for the kids who are competition-focused, the project registers them in tournaments, with Lyle often competing alongside them. Lyle also told me the story of how the project started, which took a lot of work and a lot of love.
The project Novo Sonhos starts with Cristolândia. Cristolândia began in 2009 and was to help the people who in the streets, living in the streets, to rehab from crack and their other drug addictions. And then I came here in 2011. And right in the beginning, there wasn't a sport program. The lady who used to coordinate the Cristolândia back then, she said to me, you should come to São Paulo to start to develop a sports program. I moved to São Paulo and I started to develop this program. The first was only with adults rehabbing from drug addictions. But I realized it's much better. The prevention is the kids. Because it doesn't make too much sense if you help rehab the guys, but you don't have a good prevention program. Then I started to give classes for kids, and then I saw the jiu-jitsu was the best idea. One guy from Rio de Janeiro, he came here and said to me, man, you should give jiu-jitsu classes. I was a blue belt back then. And I said, man, you're crazy, I'm blue belt. I don't give classes, I never give classes of jiu-jitsu. He left Rio de Janeiro, he came to São Paulo, stayed here for 1 month, and he brought the mats and he bought some geese. He went to the favela and talked to the kids and he said, now the project is running jiu-jitsu. And he left to Rio de Janeiro again and I started to give classes because of him. Thanks so much, as Master Ricardo. Now he's living in Portugal. He's a nice dude too. And this is the history. We're growing and here in downtown São Paulo, in the heart of Cracolândia, in the center of São Paulo, we developed something beautiful with jiu-jitsu and martial arts. So today we have like teenager classes. This is really nice because the teenagers and the adults are mixed together. And we're receiving Ryan today. He's the first American jiu-jitsu guy to come here. This is so nice to them to see some American guy. All of them are traveling to meet America, to go there and know and fight the Pan Ams and the Worlds. And it is really nice to have some guy from America train with the teenagers today.
As Lyle's students arrived, I was impressed by the diversity of the group. He had some little kids in the class, a bunch of teenagers, and some adults as well. Lyle took a few moments to introduce me to the class, and I said I was honored to be there and thanked them for having me, and then the training began. We'll be right back. As a jiu-jitsu guy, I really appreciated the level of talent that Lyle has produced in his students. The vibes on the mat were really positive, and I had a great time rolling with everybody. But as an interviewer, I was really interested in hearing more about the project from the perspective of the kids. I wanted to know what the project means to them.
Projeto na minha vida significa esperança, não só na minha vida, como na vida de muitos jovens que vêm até aqui. Tenho 15 anos, comecei a treinar com 9, mais ou menos. O que eu mais gosto do jiu-jitsu é a dinâmica, como ele ajuda as pessoas. Quem começa a treinar, assim, tipo, você pegar, ver história de pessoas com sucesso, a história dos caras é impressionante. Jiu-jitsu me ajudou, além do tatame, a me relacionar melhor com as pessoas. Era muito mais tímido. Ainda sou, né? Mas tô melhorando.
Bom, o projeto significa pra mim uma esperança e acreditar em tudo. Bom, eu estou no projeto já faz 6 anos. E provavelmente, se eu não estivesse no projeto, mesmo com a família bem estruturada que eu tenho, eu com certeza estaria fazendo bastante coisas erradas. O jiu-jitsu foi muito importante para mim, que me ajudou com a concentração. E isso foi a principal razão de eu conseguir focar, concentrar nos estudos e passar na prova. Ah, e também me ajudou a entrar na faculdade, a melhor faculdade de São Paulo. Bom, quando eu me formar, eu pretendo arranjar um bom trabalho. Se Deus quiser, estando com a faixa preta. E abrir minha academia.
O projeto para mim significa acreditar. Eu entrei no projeto Novos Sonhos com 8 anos de idade. Eu estava brincando na rua e a tia Joana passou de van perguntando quem queria fazer aula de balé. Eu gostei, minha mãe foi lá no projeto, não, foi na tia Joana e eu fiquei fazendo aula lá. Aí fiz 8 anos de balé. Aí durante esses 8 anos eu parei, eu tava fazendo jiu-jitsu também, jiu-jitsu e balé. Aí os dois não se conciliavam, entendeu? Aí eu tinha que escolher um, balé ou jiu-jitsu. Aí eu escolhi jiu-jitsu e tô 4 anos e meio. O que mais me atraiu no jiu-jitsu, eu acho que foi um pouco da competitividade e também por o balé, eu acho que pelo menos algumas professoras falam que tem que ser bem... tipo, magra, entendeu? Eu acho que eu não me vi ali. Aí eu já me vi no jiu-jitsu. Aí foi por isso que eu escolhi o jiu-jitsu do balé. O projeto me ajudou a entrar na faculdade através do jiu-jitsu, que eu fiz uma prova, uma seletiva, e ganhei mais de 50%. Aí eu vou começar a estudar lá. Em 2019, eu fui para 13 competições aqui em São Paulo e fora do estado também, e eu consegui 16 medalhas, peguei medalhas em todos os campeonatos que eu fui, sempre pegando pódio, e eu peguei medalha nos 3 principais campeonatos que eu fui, que foi o Sul-Americano, peguei 3º, no Brasileiro sem kimono 3º, e Brasileiro com kimono 3º também. Não fui campeã, mas lutei para ser, não foi dessa vez. Eu escolhi fazer faculdade de educação física porque eu já estou nesse meio e eu também acho que no futuro eu me vejo dando aula para as crianças. Aí para me dar aula para elas eu preciso aprender, absorver. Tá, não é jiu-jitsu, mas educação física é junto.
Ah, o projeto significa bastante coisa para mim, que nem ajuda no meu preparo físico, do meu trabalho, ajuda psicologicamente também. E bastante coisa também, né? Bom, o projeto, eu comecei comecei em 2015, por aí. Ainda não tinha ideia do que eu ia fazer futuramente. Não sabia que profissão eu queria seguir, se eu queria estudar, se eu queria, sei lá, fazer qualquer coisa. Aí, só que o jiu-jitsu foi abrindo as portas pra mim, foi abrindo também conhecimentos pra mim, não foi só esporte, lutar e tal. Aí foi que eu completei 18 anos e aí apareceu essa oportunidade de se alistar. Aí eu fui, meti as caras, fui passando nos processos seletivos, tal, 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 e quando fui ver, tava lá. O jiu-jitsu, tipo assim, ele é fundamental pra mim na parte de psicologicamente. Tipo, sabe, é que nem o respeito, tipo, em casa, minha mãe já me ensinou a ter o respeito, o jiu-jitsu me ensinou a ter mais respeito e tal, e no meu trabalho também ensinou a ter totalmente respeito. É, agora estou servindo aeronáutica, já vai fazer 3 anos, e estou aí na atividade aí, todo dia, na luta.
A minha coisa favorita é lutar. Quando eu fui ganhando medalhas de campeonatos do professor, de campeonatos daqui mesmo, aí minha mãe foi me elogiando, aí eu fui ficando mais atenta, aí eu fui ficando aí assim, que eu fui mudando de faixa aí, que eu comecei a lutar e vim aqui sempre.
Se você não tivesse no jiu-jitsu, o que é que você estaria fazendo?
Ah, eu estaria em casa assistindo, fazendo essas coisas que tem casa para fazer, né? Fazer o quê?
For the kids is really special because these kids here in São Paulo are used to the violent environment. And when I came here to a combat sport, it's not a violent place. It's not a violent environment. Actually, it's the opposite. Here, they find the attention and the talking, and we always talking to them about love and about life and the other perspectives of life. And here in this place, the kids are developing character and dreams. They are dreaming about other things in life. When you're poor here in Brazil, the people say you have like your fate is made. But this is not a truth. We can change your fate. And this is what we're talking to the kids. If you train, if you be smart, if you be a good person, your life can change. You don't need to live with violence for the rest of your life. With jiu-jitsu, you can live love. All of these things are good things that jiu-jitsu can bring for your life.
For adults that practice jiu-jitsu, it's our escape from everyday life. There are many benefits we get from training, but for kids, the benefits are tenfold. They say it takes a village to raise a child, because outside the home, the community around them will mold their ideas, inspirations, and lessons. But what happens when their community is broken? Who do they turn to? Two quotes come to mind as I reflect on my time spent at the Nova Sonhos project. The first is from Socrates, who said the secret of change is to focus all your energy not on fighting the old, but on building the new, which is precisely what Lyle is doing with a burning passion. He has dedicated his life to saving the new generation of kids in Krakalandia and the nearby Bom Retiro housing projects, putting them on a path to a better life. The second quote is from Anne Frank, who said, "Look at how a single candle can both defy and define the darkness." It's taken years of hard work to get the project to this point where students are going to college and beginning careers. But it's an amazing example of how one dedicated person can build something beautiful and make a real change in the world. For every kid that Lyle and Joanna bring in, they are one step away from emptying the queue of souls headed into the darkness on the streets. While the city struggles to put an end to Krakalandia, the Nova Sonhos social project is winning a deeper battle from within. And with jiu-jitsu as his sword and love as his shield, Lyle will continue to guide, inspire, and watch over these kids until his service is no longer needed.